Mentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Autumn Skies and Pumpkin Pies by Katie Winters. Narrated by Courtney Patterson. Chapter 1. It was the first day of November on the island of Martha's Vineyard, and a blisteringly cold rush of air crashed into the coastal home outside Oak Bluffs, making the window panes shiver. Meghan was up in the attic, the chilliest place in the entire house, digging through crates of Christmas, Thanksgiving, Easter, and summertime decorations, her brow furrowed. To her left was the box of Halloween decor she'd just removed from the exterior of the house. Plastic jack-o'-lanterns, a cute little witch with a green face and a wart on her nose, and candy corn lights. Last night, trick-or-treaters had come in droves, jumping out of their parents' cars in princess, superhero, witch, or silly costumes, high on sugar, crying out to Meghan, "Trick-or-treat!" But when she and her husband Hugo had woken up that morning, Hugo had opened the drapes and announced, "Autumn's over, honey. Winter came early." Meghan loved holidays. Her holiday decoration collection was a testament to that, to her belief that every day was worth celebration and a little bit of pizzazz. Gingerly, she raised the Thanksgiving decoration box from the corner and replaced it with the Halloween box, acknowledging the transition of seasons. She was 47 years old, headed toward 50, but she had her health. She had her husband and her two wonderful children, Ava and Theo. She didn't need anything else. That's when she saw the box. It was shoved into the back row of holiday boxes, its edges crinkled with a heavy skin of dust all over it. What made it remarkable was the faded ribbon around it, ornate and sophisticated. More than that, Meghan wasn't sure she'd ever seen that box before. This wasn't strange, she supposed, although she felt her life was meticulously curated and she prided herself on her organizational skills. It was more than possible she'd forgotten a random box up in the attic. As she reached for it, suppressing a sneeze from the dust, she guessed it was an old present she'd once wrapped and forgotten. Something for her sister, Oriana, or even for their mother before her death.
"Meghan, where are you?"
Hugo's warm voice swelled through the house. He'd been in his study, working, and she'd decided not to disturb him as she took down the Halloween decorations and set up the Thanksgiving ones. She'd wanted it to be a surprise. Abandoning the mysterious box and the Thanksgiving decor, Meghan headed for the attic ladder and called back. "I'm in the attic." Down in the hallway, Hugo popped out of their bedroom, wearing a crooked smile. He was 5 years older than her, 52, but was healthy and trim from his daily runs, with a mostly gray head of curly hair that Meghan adored. Sometimes it was hard for Meghan to believe they'd done so much life together, that they'd raised two children, that they'd traveled all over the world.
"What are you doing up here?"
Hugo teased her. Meghan laughed. "Now that I'm covered in dust, I'm asking myself the same thing."
"Do you need help?"
Meghan turned and stepped lightly down the ladder, abandoning the shadows and entering the warmth of the hallway below. "Not in the slightest. You're going running?" Hugo was wearing a pair of running pants, a thick hoodie, and a big hat.
"I have to get used to running in the cold one of these days."
"You're a brave man." Meghan sauntered toward him, rolled up onto her toes, and kissed him softly on the lips. As their kiss broke, the doorbell rang downstairs. Who could that be?
"I have a guess."
Meghan and Hugo padded down the staircase, eyes to the front window, as Oriana leaped from her car and walked gingerly up the ice-glazed sidewalk. This was typical Oriana-Meghan behavior. Frequently, they stopped by one another's home without calling or texting first, as though they still lived down the hall from one another and were popping in and out of each other's bedrooms. Just before Oriana rang the bell, Meghan opened it, and Oriana collapsed over her in a chilly hug. "Winter is early," she cried.
"I caught Meghan up in the attic," Hugo said. "Her lips were blue."
Meghan swatted him. "You should talk. You're the one going on a run." Oriana's eyes were saucers. I say this every year, Hugo, but you're insane.
Hugo saluted her on his way out the door, fitting his earphones into his ears and disappearing down the road. For a moment, Oriana and Meghan watched him out the window, the long lope of his stride, until he disappeared around a line of trees.
I wish I had half his discipline, Oriana joked.
Meghan wanted to point out that Oriana's discipline was simply directed in a different place, that she was a killer art dealer who frequently handled million-dollar-plus deals. But before she could, Oriana interrupted to say,
I heard a rumor Ava's coming back tonight.
Meghan's heart lifted.
Yes! The plane lands at Logan at 4, and then she and Finn are driving back to the island. They're coming for dinner tonight, as is Theo. You must be over the moon, Oriana breathed.
They weren't gone very long, Meghan said. But you know how I get when my babies aren't both on the island.
I feel the same, Oriana assured her.
Meghan led Oriana to the kitchen, where she put a kettle on the stovetop and searched through boxes of tea. Ginger for Oriana and green for Meghan. Ava and Finn had been on a trip to Italy, where they'd celebrated 6 years of their relationship, a gorgeous milestone for two people on their way to the rest of their lives together.
I was thinking, Meghan began as the kettle bubbled and spat, that Ava started dating Finn at the same age I was when I started dating Hugo.
Yes, but you already had two kids by the time you were 26, Oriana pointed out. Meghan wrinkled her nose and spoke in a silly whisper.
I know better than to push for grandchildren. Ava is finding herself, you know. Don't you feel like their generation is always trying to find themselves? Oriana asked.
When we were that age, we charged into life, made tons of mistakes, and figured it out as we went. I can't remember sitting down and actually asking myself, who am I?
Meghan giggled as she poured hot water.
I can't imagine you slowing down long enough for that. You started your career and your family at the same time, in New York City, no less.
Sometimes Reese and I look at each other and shake our heads, Oriana said. We were crazy to think it would work.
But it did, Meghan reminded her.
But yours did too.
Oriana blew on the steam over her tea. You knew you wanted to be a trader since you were a teenager. You sat in Dad's study for hours, asking him questions, studying him.
You must have thought I was so lame, Meghan said.
I definitely did, Oriana teased. But how many women can say they taught their husbands their trade rather than the other way around? Meghan smiled inwardly, secretly very proud of that. At the age of 20, when she and Hugo had officially begun dating, she'd already carved out a successful career for herself in day trading, selling stocks and bonds back in the pre-internet age. On their first date, Hugo had been flabbergasted with what he called her brilliance, saying,
I feel so lame. I'm just a manager at a coffee shop, thinking about going back to school.
It had taken Hugo about 6 months to ask Meghan to teach him how to trade. By then, of course, Meghan had already gotten pregnant with Ava. They'd needed the money.
How is work going? Oriana asked, hands wrapped comfortably around her mug of tea.
Better than ever, Meghan answered, trying to suppress a smile. Hugo and I have a quiet competition going, and we're trading off teaching Theo the ropes as well. Meghan explained her plans for the next few hours, that she wanted to decorate the house for the Thanksgiving season, set the table with their mother's china, and prepare a feast for her children. Oriana showed photographs of the art project she, Reese, and her grandson, Benny, had completed that morning. Little clay pots they'd fired and painted. Benny's was a thick, bulky rock, while Oriana's was sleek, painted turquoise, something you could have picked up in a tourist shop.
Have you ever considered making your own art and selling it? Meghan asked, flicking through the photographs on Oriana's phone.
Gosh, no, Oriana said. I'm not the artist in the family. That's Alexa.
Meghan gave her a rueful look.
You've spent your life championing other people's art. That means you have a real artistic eye.
Oriana rarely got embarrassed, which was why Meghan was surprised to see her cheeks flash with pink. She took her phone back and pocketed it, drawing her blonde hair behind her ears. "I forgot to ask you," Oriana said. "Do you know what you're wearing to the wedding this weekend?"
"I'm struggling between two dress options," Meghan explained, allowing Oriana to change the subject. "An ochre and a forest green."
"You look fantastic in forest green," Oriana said, worrying her lower lip.
"I need to get organized. That wedding is going to be fancy, and I have to look the part."
Meghan laughed.
"Did you see how panicked Charlie looked last week?"
Oriana's eyes widened.
"I get it. Wedding stress is killer.
On top of that, Sheila is his first daughter to get married. I'm sure he's going through about 1,000 different emotions per day."
"I have a feeling Shauna is keeping everybody afloat," Meghan said, speaking of Charlie's wife.
"That doesn't mean she's not going crazy, too. But like most women, she's better at hiding it," Oriana said knowingly.
After she finished her tea, Oriana rattled off a list of everything else she had to do that day, including a stop at the pharmacy and the grocery store. Meghan walked her to the door, wrapped her in a hug, and told her to drive safely. As Oriana backed out of the driveway, Meghan kept her eyes on the foggy horizon, hunting for some sign of her long-limbed husband. But often, when he went running, he committed to 10 miles or more, which meant he was still out there somewhere, his heart pumping, his rock music blaring in his ears. She made a mental note to make sure his running clothes were warm enough. Maybe they needed to go shopping for more layers. Meghan had decided to make Ava's favorite meal, a Cajun seafood pasta recipe that Meghan had mastered over the years, frequently pulling it out to help Ava through emotional eras of her life, through fights with friends or previous breakups with high school boyfriends. She wanted to use it to remind Ava just how wonderful home life could be, especially after her magical time in Italy.
"There's no place like home," Meghan imagined her saying.
Meghan returned to the attic to fetch the Thanksgiving decorations, thinking she could set up a few things here and there before she got started on dinner. Back in the dusty, filled room, her shoulders tightened with the chill, and she grabbed the box quickly, shuffling back toward the ladder. But as she went, her eyes scanned that dusty box, the mysterious one with the ribbon around it, and she grabbed it and stacked it on top of the Thanksgiving cornucopia. Whatever it was, she would deal with it now. With the ladder set back in place, Meghan carried the boxes to her study, which she'd decorated exclusively with her own taste in mind. Floral wallpaper, a thickly cushioned couch the color of mustard yellow. It was here she conducted her business. Here she made her money. And as she dropped down on the mustard couch and gingerly removed the top of the ribboned box, she thought abstractly,
"Wow, how lucky am I?"
The box was filled with thin, yellowed pages, upon which were scrawled many lines of handwriting Meghan didn't recognize. Meghan jumped through initial explanations, that this was a family member's handwriting, perhaps her mother's sister's, or that Theo's ex-girlfriend had written him numerous notes that he'd shoved into the attic, unable to throw away. But Theo was only 24, and these letters were clearly older than that. Her heart burning with curiosity, Meghan unfurled the top letter and read the salutation at the top. "My darling Hugo." Immediately, Meghan dropped the paper, watching as it floated like a dead leaf to the ground. She had the sudden sensation that she was no longer supplied with the right amount of oxygen, which in turn would trigger a fainting spell to the carpeting. After a labored breath, Meghan forced herself to read the first few lines of the next letter in the pile. "My darling Hugo, you can't imagine how little I sleep these days, knowing the future I'd thought was bound to be ours is now at risk. All my life, I'd longed for a love like ours, a love that allows me to float away from the horrors of my real day-to-day. When I first met you, I knew everything was about to change. You told me you have to think and that you need space. But Hugo, you're the only person in the world I don't need space from. I want to sit with you, scream at you, allow you to scream at me. I want us to unburden ourselves from our own emotions and come clean. But most of all, I want to prove the depths of my love for you. I want you to know just how much I'm willing to do to keep our love alive. I cannot accept that our engagement might be over. I need to believe in our future. I need you." Meghan blinked up from the letter. Tears streamed from her eyes, blurring her study and dotting the note below. Her thoughts shimmering with panic, she went through thousands upon thousands of conversations with Hugo over the years, trying to drum up a memory in which he'd told her about a previous engagement. There was nothing. Feeling like a masochist, bent on destroying her own heart, Meghan continued to read the letters. They were all addressed to Hugo, and they spoke of a profound relationship, a harsh disagreement, a broken engagement, and finally, a threat. "My darling Hugo, I hear you loud and clear. Most of my letters have remained unanswered, and I feel as though I'm screaming over an empty abyss and hearing only my own echoes coming back. The only thing keeping me from hating you is that I love you so much. But now, I must set a boundary. If I don't hear back from you, you will never see me or hear from me again. The love we once had for one another won't matter in the slightest. It will be as though we never knew each other. And Hugo, I will teach myself to hate you. I will not uphold a single memory with you. It will be as though all the love we shared never existed. I implore you to listen to reason, to come to me and say what I know you feel, that you love me so completely and that you don't want what we have to die. This is your final chance." Suddenly, Meghan heard the creak of footsteps on the staircase and the warm call of her husband.
"Meghan, I'm home."
His voice was clipped short, his breath ragged after his run. Meghan staggered forward, allowing the box of letters to tumble from her lap and onto the floor. Her vision filled with dark spots as though she was about to faint.
"Meghan?"
Hugo called again. Meghan wrapped her hands around her throat and stared out the window, listening as the harsh winter winds crashed against the sturdy coastal home. The house she and Hugo had bought so many years ago when their love had been the only thing Meghan had fully understood. Had she been a fool? It felt as though the foundation upon which she'd built her love for Hugo was now filled with mold, crumbling. She had the sudden desire to kick it and watch it completely fall apart.
"I'm here."
Meghan's voice was shaky as she called back to him, feeling him move about the second floor. Hugo walked toward her study door, and Meghan's veins were shot through with adrenaline and fear. It was as though the boogeyman lurked in the hallway, ready to nab her.
"Are you working?"
Hugo asked.
Yeah.
Hugo's voice quivered with confusion.
"Are you okay?"
He paused.
"Did something happen with Oriana?"
Hugo was probably referring to Meghan and Oriana's recent confusing time, in which Meghan had thought Oriana was avoiding her, and Oriana had simply been dealing with a ravenous blackmailer bent on destroying her art career. It had been a misunderstanding, to say the least, one she and Oriana had easily repaired.
"No, she just had to go to the store,"
Meghan responded. Hugo shifted his weight on the other side of the door.
"Can I come in?"
"No!"
Meghan's voice was high-pitched.
"I mean, I'm really in the middle of something right now. Why don't you go shower? I'll finish up here and start dinner."
"All right. Just let me know if you need anything,"
Hugo said quietly, his ego damaged. He knew her well and could feel something was wrong, something he couldn't put his finger on. But as Hugo went to their bedroom and started the shower, Meghan stewed in fear and anger that threatened to fill her chest and drown her. She'd known and loved Hugo Porter for 27 years of her life. She'd given him everything, every detail of her past, every opinion she'd ever held. Why hadn't he thought to tell her about his profound romance? And then a thought struck her like a hammer to the head. Was it possible Hugo had dated this woman while married to Meghan?
Was it possible he'd betrayed her?
Chapter 2. The White Whale Bookstore was Oak Bluffs' only indie bookstore, located in a quaint Victorian home painted a soft lavender blue. Daniel Bloom rented the space from the owners, who were self-described literary lovers, for a monthly rate he understood to be much less than most other rentals downtown. Even still, Daniel struggled to make ends meet, often kicking himself for ever opening a bookstore in the first place. He loved books, but it seemed, more and more, that the rest of the world did not. Lucky for him, a novelist named Layla Johnson currently resided on Nantucket, the island to the east. On a recent trip to Martha's Vineyard, she'd strolled into his bookstore, and Daniel had leaped at the chance to talk to her, explaining he'd fallen in love with her writing as a younger man and followed her career obsessively. She was in her mid-50s, he thought, just a little bit younger than him, but with a dense career behind her, one that should have made her a lot more arrogant than she was. When he sheepishly asked if she would be willing to do a signing at his bookstore, she'd agreed, explaining she'd never fallen in love with a part of the world more and wanted to give back to these islands. "People need local bookstores," she'd said. "They're essential parts of the community, and I've hated watching so many of them close over the years." It was November 3rd, a Friday, and Daniel was setting up for the book signing. He positioned a long table near the window, upon which he stacked numerous copies of Layla's novels. According to a social media event he'd made, at least 45 people planned to be in attendance, and he hoped they would bring their friends. More than that, people were out and about on the sidewalk, and he wrote, "Layla Johnson, book signing," on a sign in chalk, hoping that would lure more people in. Christmas was around the corner. Maybe people would buy presents along with a few Layla Johnson signed copies. Layla arrived 20 minutes before the signing was set to begin. She had dark reddish-brown hair and an honest, nervous smile, and she perused Daniel's collection before setting up at the signing table, explaining she was living at the Copperfield House right now, teaching a writing seminar.
"I'm jealous of your students," Daniel said with a sigh.
"Did you ever study writing?" Layla asked, her hands around a Jane Austen classic.
"I took a few classes in college," Daniel explained. "I think I was too arrogant. I couldn't take criticism, and I found another path."
"Taking criticism is tough," Layla said. "I still struggle with it."
"I can't imagine anyone criticizing your work," Daniel said. "You're Layla Johnson."
"I'm an imperfect person with many problems," Layla corrected, "like everyone else."
Just as Daniel had hoped, the 45 people who'd said they were coming on social media brought their friends, and very soon the bookstore was full. A line snaked around the space and out the door, with numerous Layla Johnson fans shivering outside, hands shoved in pockets, talking excitedly. A thick ceiling of clouds kicked snowflakes to the ground, and Daniel put on Christmas songs, hoping it would remind people to buy presents. After Layla signed books for a full 2 hours, incredible, Daniel thought, she suggested she could do a reading from one of her more recent books for those still in the store. People leaped at the chance, either standing toward the back or actually sitting on the floor in front of Layla's table. Daniel was behind the cash register, alternating between listening to Layla and considering what kind of boon this day had been for his bookstore's future. Bit by bit, he felt the panic and anxiety dissolving from his chest, and he took deep, powerful breaths. Maybe everything was going to be okay. But just as he allowed himself a moment of peace, everything fell apart again. The door burst open, and an old woman appeared. She wore a dirty white dressing gown, and her white hair was unkempt, like a scarecrow's. She was very frail, her mouth a scab of chapped lips. Immediately, Layla stuttered over her words, and everyone in the crowd turned to stare at her. Daniel felt as though he was having an out-of-body experience. How was this happening?
Daniel bolted around the side of the cash register and placed his hand gently on his mother's shoulder just as she cried out in a harsh, rattly voice,
"Danny! Where the heck is the remote?"
The crowd stared at Daniel and his mother, Pam, with horrible, suspicious eyes. She'd interrupted Layla Johnson's terrific reading and torn a hole through their perfect Friday afternoon. Daniel raised a shaking hand and locked eyes with Layla, saying,
"Please, go on."
Layla got the hint and bowed her head again, returning her fans to her fictional world. Meanwhile, Daniel led his mother around the cash register and into the back room, alternating between fuming and feeling frightened. He placed his mother in a cushioned reading chair in the office, one he often sat in to peruse potential buys, and checked her vitals. Her heartbeat was, as always, soft and dangerously slow. But her color was all right. Her eyes were rabid, proof of her confusion. A part of him wanted to curl up against her and cry, if only to remind her that she was his mother. She was supposed to take care of him. But those days were over now. The roles had been reversed.
"Mom, why did you leave home?"
Daniel asked quietly, not wanting to frighten her or anger her. Pam sucked in her cheeks.
"I don't know why a woman can't go where she pleases. It isn't the 19th century anymore, you know."
Daniel sighed and rubbed the back of his neck, then stood to turn on the electric water kettle to make her a mug of tea. As it boiled, his mother blathered on about something that enraged her, something that didn't make any sense to Daniel, as Daniel removed his phone from his pocket and dialed Cindy. Cindy answered groggily on the fourth ring.
"Hello?"
Her voice was thick with mucus.
"Hi, Cindy."
Daniel tried his best to keep his anger at bay.
"My mother is here."
Cindy coughed into the phone, making Daniel's ears ring.
"Beg your pardon?"
Was she being purposefully obtuse?
"My mother is here. You were supposed to be watching her."
Cindy yelped.
"Oh my gosh, she was just here."
Daniel closed his eyes as waves of annoyance crashed against him like the waves off the Nantucket Sound.
"Did you fall asleep again?"
Cindy was quiet. Daniel hated himself in this moment, feeling as though he was a high school principal trying to shame a student. But Cindy was a 45-year-old out-of-work nurse who'd agreed to sit with his mother at their home while Daniel was at the bookstore. He understood how boring that task was. He'd done it plenty of times himself. But didn't he pay her enough not to sleep on the job?
"I'm so sorry, Dan,"
Cindy said, using an abbreviation for Daniel's name that Daniel really didn't like.
"It won't happen again."
Daniel stuttered with disbelief, trying to drown his anger. He really couldn't afford to fire Cindy. She was the only person with the time and inclination to sit at home with his mother. And with the holiday season coming up, he needed her more than ever.
"I'll come to the shop and get her right away,"
Cindy said, her voice hardened with resolve.
"Can you bring her coat and shoes? She has two different ones on right now,"
Daniel said, eyeing the right foot of his mother's tennis shoe and the left foot of her saddle shoe, which she'd previously worn to church before the dementia had gotten too bad. After Daniel hung up the phone, his mother glowered at him.
"You know I don't like it when Lisa stays out too late."
Daniel struggled to ignore this, a horrific reminder of the past. It felt like a piece of shrapnel shoved through his heart.
"She'll be home soon, Mom,"
Daniel said instead.
"Why don't you drink your tea? I'll turn on the television for you."
Daniel set up his MacBook in front of her and put on her old favorite TV show, The Golden Girls. Immediately, his mother's face became slack and her eyes twitched as she followed the women across the screen. Hoping she was all right alone for the moment, Daniel hurried back into the bookstore to listen to the final few paragraphs of Layla's reading. As she finished, he touched his cheeks to find them wet with tears. Wonderfully, many of the people who'd stayed to listen to Layla read decided to hang around the store, drink coffee, eat the baked goods Daniel had set out, and buy more books.
Daniel allowed his heart to fill with gratefulness as he watched the revenue of the day go up and up and up. And in between the heads of the customers who approached the register, he finally spotted Cindy, bustling in from the snow, her face stricken. Perhaps because of her nerves about potentially losing her job, she tried to burst through the customers to talk to Daniel, to apologize again, but Daniel gave her a dark look and said very quietly,
"She's in the back. Wait with her until I'm finished here."
He didn't want to frighten anyone off. After the bookstore cleared, Layla approached him with her coat on, her eyes heavy. Under her breath, she said,
"Is everything okay, Daniel?"
Maybe because Daniel had read so many of Layla's books over the years, he had a false sense of her knowing him and vice versa. He nearly burst with the story that his mother's dementia had destroyed her, that his life was now filled only with her health problems and the failing bookstore.
"My mother is sick," he said simply,
trying to make the fact of it smaller than it was.
"It's why I came back to Martha's Vineyard in the first place, to take care of her."
"That's so kind of you," Layla said, her brow furrowed.
"Her nurse fell asleep," he explained, "and she must have snuck out. It's miraculous she still knows the way to the store."
"That's proof of the power of a mother's love, right?"
Layla suggested.
"She knows right where you are, no matter what."
Daniel wanted to laugh at that. He imagined himself falling to the floor, crying with laughter. But Layla Johnson didn't know the truth, that before Pam's diagnosis, she'd been one of the most cruel and manipulative people in the world. He still woke up sweating with memories of what she'd said to him as a kid. No, she'd never been physically violent, besides a few smacks here and there. But words had a way of lodging themselves into your psyche and affecting you long after. Daniel thanked Layla again for her help and watched as she stepped out into the November snow, disappearing around the corner to fetch her car. He then counted to 10 before he headed back to find his mother asleep in the reading chair and Cindy captivated with the Golden Girls.
"This show is hilarious," Cindy said, trying to make peace. "I understand why your mom loves it."
Daniel decided to close the bookstore early, send Cindy back home, and walk his mother the 3 blocks back to the house in which she'd raised him and his sister, Lisa. It was a 3-bedroom, 2-story house with a tiny backyard that had once flourished with Pam's garden, but was now unkempt and brown. The front door was unlocked, presumably because Cindy had forgotten to lock it, but Daniel decided not to bother himself with getting angry about that. There was so much else to consider. Daniel drew his mother a bath, hoping to warm her up. It was 6 in the evening, and his stomach rumbled with hunger, which he would eventually satiate with a microwavable meal, maybe chicken penne or lasagna. It had been a long time since he'd eaten something that didn't taste like sand. With his mother in the bath, Daniel set up a speaker to play classical music, which often calmed her. He then sat in the hallway, in sight of his mother, never far, just in case something happened. He'd read once that you could drown with just a teaspoon of water. As he sat glumly, thinking about the wide expanse of emotions from yet another day in his life, his phone buzzed with a text from his wife. "Gina. Hey, I still haven't heard from you about the papers. It's been 6 months, Daniel, for crying out loud. I, for one, want to move on. Don't you?" Chapter 3. The ferry from Martha's Vineyard to Nantucket lasted approximately 1 hour and 10 minutes. It was Saturday morning, 4 hours before they were needed at the welcoming reception prior to Sheila and Jonathan's wedding, and Meghan was wrapped in her winter coat in the cafe of the ferry, peering through the thick plastic glass at an ocean that frothed angrily. Beneath it, she could feel the immensity of an underwater world nobody quite understood. Thousands and thousands of leagues of underwater animals and lost shipwrecks and danger.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.